clause-wise details. Clause one, scope, to be honest, nothing has changed as such. The only thing is that the value delivery has been separately called out earlier. So if you see the bullet point one, that's pretty critical. Earlier, we used to say that you need to deliver service requirements as per to meet service requirements. Now, if you see that extra piece has come saying you need to deliver to meet service requirements and to deliver value. So that value recognition has started from the word go. Some words have been modified. So in 2018, we use the term service provider anymore. We call it as organization. And customer is also a word that we have started using. Earlier, we used to use the word called organization. That has changed to customer, etc. Moving on, normative reference. It's just a blank placeholder place, so don't worry. Clause 3, if you see subclauses, as I told you, it has been segregated pretty well. And there are some new terms, some new replacements and so on. You can go through in your leisure. Clause 4, general requirements of service management system. If you see certain changes, like the value proposition has been highlighted again. But then there is a very interesting point, guys. Management representative role is not separately called out anymore. There is no MR role, no separate section for MR. They just say that you need to identify all generic roles that are applicable on your service management system and make sure they are available. That's it. So MR can be a part of that. But then there is no separate role called MR, and you are not going to sit with the MR saying, do you do this? Do you do that? That's all gone. That's excellent. Clause 4.2. Earlier, we used to call this as governance of processes. So the idea was, we will be only focusing on those parties whom you are dependent on for process management. So if you have outsourced your incident management, then we go and talk to them. But now it is no more limited to processes that has been sourced. It can also be, as you see, services or service components that has been outsourced. So the scope has gone broader. But at the same time, earlier the focus was to control the processes themselves, not the party who is practicing it. Now the focus has become controlling the parties and not the processes or the services that they are providing. Documentation management remains pretty much the same. Only thing is that management of record and management of document used to be called separately. Now that's diluted. It's all the same. And it's no more called as documentation management. It's called as documented information. That's it. And then clause 4.4, if you remember, resource management, which talks about human resource and so on, that has been changed to multiple clauses. Clause 7.1, resources, 7.2, competence, awareness, and knowledge. So the scope now covers, the important point is for knowledge, you need to note, knowledge base and specialization is no more enough to be with your own employees. So that has changed. Anybody, if you see the definition, persons doing work under the organization's control. So you are the organization, you are the service provider. Whatever services you are providing, anybody who is doing work under your guidance, your control, that could be from your org or could be from a partner's org, whoever you need, or maybe the knowledge base that I'm talking about, not only your knowledge base, but when they are providing your service, they should also have required knowledge bases to do justice. All that is under scope. Moving on, clause 4.5, as I told you, Plan Do Check Act, SMS. That Plan Do Check Act has been shifted to clause 6, planning, as I told you, and clause 9 and 10 for the rest of the pieces. Everything, by the way, let me give you a thumb rule. Everything that you're seeing, don't tell you, I mean, when I say no changes, it does not mean that there are no changes. Everything has gone through a very crisp and clear, clarified definition. It's excellent. So that is a common change. So we have not called that out. All we are saying here are the specific changes that we see there. So no great changes here. It remains pretty much the same. Going to clause 5, design and transition, as I told you. So design and transition has been shifted to service design and transition, as you see, clause 8.5.2. And then it is, if you see, also included would be clause 9 and 10, more detailing and so on. But again, no great change, guys. Only thing is it's way more clearer now. Coming to 6, clause 6 of ISO 20000 2011. All these clauses are, by the way, 2011 clauses, and then we have mapped them to 2018. So if you see under clause 6, service delivery processes, I will just highlight the important ones. Clause 6.1, service level management, if you see, it has been split into three: service level management, service catalog, and the management of internal supplies for OLA. Great change. Clause 6.2, if you see, service reporting, that has been shifted to clause 9.4, and it has become way lighter in terms of expectations. Great change again. Next, clause 6.3, service continuity and availability management, it has been broken into two parts: service availability management and service continuity. So service continuity has not changed, but guys, very important point here: service availability has gone through a considerable change. That change is that availability plan is no more a requirement. You don't need to create an availability plan. As long as you are defining the requirements for availability and accordingly setting your availability targets, good enough. And monitoring that, of course, and improving, of course. But then there is no plan document required, no more a requirement. Moving on, if you see quite a few clauses, 6.4, budgeting and accounting, no great change, guys, remains the same. Only thing is, earlier they used to define a solid set of line items that are mandated in the budgeting or accounting sheet. That thing has been taken off. The line item, the details are to be chosen by you. Then if you see clause 6.5, capacity management is broken into two parts now: capacity and demand, as I explained. In capacity, one important thing, many of us went through a lot of pain. There was a requirement of performance tuning. It said you need to do a performance tuning. And auditors asked, okay, have you done tuning of performance? Now, many a times, if it is a small organization and if they are not too technology heavy, performance tuning becomes a very confusing piece of work. And it makes no sense for you to make it mandated. So now they have realized it and it has been taken out. That's a good, great thing. And then information security management, no changes. Moving on, 7.0, relationship management. So BRM, business relationship management, no changes. Supplier management, as I explained to you, it's broken into two parts: supplier management, external as well as internal. And for internal, you have OLA. That's a major change. 8.0, resolution processes. Again, incident and service requests, that has been split into two: incident and request fulfillment, separate ones. And problem management remains the same, no major change. As you see, it says, except that no documented procedure is mandated. By the way, that's a common thing for every process. No process has any more a mandatory requirement to have a process document or procedure document. Moving on, clause 9, control processes. Config management is broken into two: asset and config, as I told you earlier. 9.2, change management, remains change, no changes. Oh, oops, I missed a point. Configuration management has gone through a major change. That is called CMDB. So CMDB is no more a mandate in 2018. So this was always a big point of contention across the world, whether CMDB should be mandated or not. It's a question. Many organizations said that we are so small, CMDB doesn't even make sense. Why can't we do a configuration management plan and have a list of CIs, of course, but don't have this relationship and all those details and maintain it as a CMDB. I mean, of course, I'll have a list of CIs, but I won't call it as a CMDB and I won't follow the policies that CMDB asked me to. So why can I not do that? Why is this mandated? So if you see, after all these global discussions, ISO has realized and they have appreciated the differences, and now it's no more mandate. That's a major change. And then, of course, clause 9.3, the last one, guys, nothing changes. It remains the same. With this, I end. So no more points from my end as such.